So George, there's been a lot of hype and talk for the last couple of years all around AI and machine learning.
Lots of hype.
Right? I mean, would you say, like, what are, you know, what's one of the big questions, even in the first, you know, when we just talk about AI and machine learning, I think just even those terms, they're often used interchangeably, right? And but they don't necessarily mean the same thing.
Don't necessarily mean the same thing at all. And there's a number of things exist here. There's the fact that, you know, when you speak to a lot of people about AI or machine learning, especially in cybersecurity, they're really not that interested. I mean, I know myself and Chad and Hal here in the organization, we actually talked about machine learning and AI a lot to people, a lot of MSPs. And the real thing was, well, you know, how does it work? You know, does it work? They weren't really interested in, it's a bit like driving a car. You don't need to know how the engine works as long as you can get from A to B. But I think the problem is that sort of apathy leaves a lot of space for a misunderstanding about what the technology is, what it does, and what it can deliver.
Right.
And I think the message that, you know, myself and Chad and the others were trying to get over was the fact you actually need to know about this stuff. It is important, and it's going to, you know, play a more and growing role in your business going forward.
Yeah, absolutely. And as this survey that we've conducted over the past several months shows, that, you know, our MSP partners and those businesses, you know, definitely want to use technology or have already adopted technology. You know, nearly 3/4, 74%, you know, have begun using some form of AI or ML in their organizations. Now, you know, Webroot obviously focuses specifically on the cybersecurity element of this, but AI and the extension of machine learning and deep learning and you know, processing big volumes of data has a lot of applications that I think have made our lives easier today. You know, how Google algorithms work, Netflix, but you know, how Webroot uses this is, you know, in a really unique way that is aimed at discovering threats proactively, being able to manage an increasingly large volume of information and helping, you know, really rapidly identify emerging threats as they're emerging.
Yeah, I think businesses are using it the same way. They're looking at, you know, their data stores. They're going in there and saying, well, you know, can this give me some business intelligence, give me some trends? If I'm a retailer, you know, what does it tell me? You know, the problems are the same. You've got vast amounts of data that you're collecting the whole time and trying to make some sense out of that and get some value out of that. And, you know, cybersecurity is no different from any of those areas of those businesses. It's trying to, you know, take that vast amount of data and find what I'd call the needles in the haystack, because that's really what you're looking for. You're looking for, you know, the things that are going to give you some actionable information and intelligence.
Right. And interestingly enough, the survey also kind of points to that, in that over half of the businesses that are using some form of AI or ML in their current day-to-day process, they don't really know what that means. And I think, again, it's not as cut and dry as it's just this. I think it's the application and how you are wielding this type of computing power and the ability to sort through data and to find those trends and the information that's valuable given the implementation. You know, I think that's what makes Webroot certainly unique in how we've been able to, you know, use this technology, sort of be an innovator in this field as far as how ML is applied to large volumes of data, you know, especially with the security lens of discovery of new threats, you know, to building types of intelligent machine-driven models that can, you know, identify phishing sites in real time. And, you know, the impacts that really has for a business. You know, it's important for them to really understand how we're using ML and AI. But at the same time, I think it's also interesting to talk about how adversaries are using the same type of technology to, you know, process through the data that they've collected in a breach or to rapidly investigate the data that's available on a newly compromised network.
I think David mentioned that we generate about 1,000 new models a day. I think it's a huge volume when you think about it.
Oh, absolutely. Well, that's part of our feedback loop. And I think that's, you know, an important element to understand about, you know, why Webroot's implementation of ML has been so successful is that we've been doing this for over a decade now.
And, true.
You know, it's not been the same process. It's been iterative improvements, but leveraging old data to, you know, allow us to have smarter future data. And just the enormous volume that we generate from our customers on a daily basis, you know, I love the concept that our system gets smarter and more aware with every new customer we add. Yeah. And with every new day that passes, it's more intelligent and more capable.
Yeah.
Which leads to these extremely high levels of efficacy, you know, against zero-day phishing sites, against zero-day malware, against zero-day malicious website hosting. So
yeah, phishing is my favorite topic this year because it's one where, you know, you can really see it being applied in different ways. I mean, the real-time anti-phishing that we apply to actually looking, okay, we look at the score, somebody's on their endpoint, they click on a link and they shouldn't click on. we realize maybe that link is not very sound. So we actually say, well, actually, we're going to put some real-time anti-phishing around it. We then go and go to that site, intercede, if you like, on behalf of the user, and then use real-time machine learning and milliseconds, basically, to make a very accurate decision whether that's a phishing site or not and block it.
Right.
Now, that's key. You know, it's key not to get someone to do the click in the first place, so we obviously use our awareness training to do that. And then even if something does get through, if they're using DNS, there's an element they could get caught then going out the gate,
trying
to go to the command and control server or wherever else they're trying to go. So, and I think the thing is that people, they associate, you know, phishing is a really good example because phishing initiates so many other things. I mean,
right. We
talk about the Swiss Army knife approach that phishing has these days for hackers in the sense that, you know, they use phishing basically to download really anything they want onto that device.
Maybe
not an attack just stealing credentials or scamming someone into money. It's about getting Trojans down there. It's about a long-term malware down into their systems and infiltrating the rest of their network. So it's, you know, this stuff is important. And be able to see that and happening in real time and stop it or prevent it from the first place, that to me is, you know, definitely, you know, something that we've shined at going forward, you know, at the moment and are improving on the whole time.
Well, certainly. I mean, if you can really do a good job in preventing phishing and the impacts of that, you've gone a long way in really eliminating a big chunk of the risk that you face as an organization. So,
I think,
the way that Webroot's been able to apply ML to how we designed our real-time anti-phishing technology where, you know, again, it's at the time of encounter that we're able to detect these sites in real time.
To do that well, you know, you have to do things in a very timely way, a very accurate way, a very reliable way. And why that's important is that way, if you do it that way, then you can make accurate decisions.
Right.
And I think that's the real underlying thing is that you've got technology that's underlyingly there making decisions for you, automating those decision processes without you having to say, well, why did it do this? And, you know, we've been talking about earlier today about, you know, how some of our MSPs will say, well, why did you block that site?
Why did you
do that?
They want the attribution chain. They want to know why is this an IP address? Like, when did it do the spam emails? And I think what's cool is, like, we have that information.
We
can provide them, you know, the evidence to say that, hey, this isn't just because we said so.
No.
Here's, like, the actual evidence. And, again, being able to do that at scale at the time of where, you know, something was maybe newly added to our threat URL list. And we've now prevented it, and the MSP sees that in their console and says, hey, this user was just protected from something that just became malicious 30 minutes ago.
Yeah.
Well, how did you guys know about
that?
Right? And we can say, well, you know, we analyzed that data, and, you know, we found an artifact in JavaScript that is common to something we know about, and we are now aware of that, and here's why, right?
But it might be because we just found that one thing, and we were able to associate it with other things,
sure,
and that actually fired off a whole lot of things.
Absolutely.
That one little correlation
can sometimes be all you
all
need
takes,
to really to know
true.
Something malicious is going on. So
it's clever. It's smart. I mean, we say smarter technology, but it is smart.
Oh, it is. It really is, actually. I mean, it makes it easy, you know, because a lot of the heavy lifting is done through intelligent implementation of machine learning. And the processing power that we're able to harness with our cloud network is it's nothing short of really amazing that you know, we have something that we've built on iteratively over the past 10 years to really create a highly intelligent, super efficient system that's capable of providing protection at the spot of where it's needed, at the time of where it's needed.
It's that concept of individual protection. Again, that was something that's very funny. I remember years ago when we first launched Secure Anywhere, the endpoint, one of the guys, analyst at Forrester, said, well, you know, you're very different because you actually protect each device individually and each user individually.
Right.
And I said, yes, we do.
Yes.
We basically benchmark the individual or benchmark the device. And from then on, we sort of look at what's happening to that individual device and we're reporting on that and analyzing on that and applying you know, our threat intelligence on that individual device. And I said, obviously, it's collective as well, because if we find out on one thing, then obviously, you know, if we see it anywhere else, we immediately stop it somewhere else if it's malicious. So I said it has a collective benefit. I think the collective benefit, which was probably huge 6 years ago, as you said, has probably become less and less of a thing now because things are so unique and everything's
polymorphic. But you need that visibility, though, If you don't have that per endpoint visibility, that infection that's meant for that one endpoint that's never going to be seen on any other endpoint, you're going to miss it, right?
Exactly.
And you know, that's been like a core principle of how we built our data collection is ensuring that we have the eyes and ears where they need to be, right? And
for the MSPs, I mean, the benefit for them is obviously the infections are stopped at a higher rate. They're not getting
support calls. It just works, as they say,
It just works, but it just works because it's not looking just at one thing. I think that's another thing I've seen with next gen, you know, being so popular out there, and people talk about next gen.
Very narrowly focused on
very narrow focused products.
Right.
So they do one job extraordinarily well, but they ignore all the other things.
Right.
So you're on your browser, and hey, we don't protect the browser.
Right.
We're not looking at the browser.
Right. You know, it's so, like, where's all this information coming in and out of?
So, you know, what's that endpoint protection really delivering? It's only delivering something very, very narrow.
Absolutely. The layered approach is super important. There are many different ways that attacks can come in. And it's important to be aware of those and to monitor the changes, right? I mean, we've seen a lot of innovation over the last 5 years with, you know, how ransomware works to fileless-based malware.
Process injection.
You can thank like the NSA for several exploits that have been leaked into the wild, and you know the flood of infections that have really piggybacked off some of these, you know, holes in the backbones of how data and the internet are connected. But again, you know, this is why it's important. To still have endpoint protection, right? It's become sort of a necessity today. You know, if you're an SMB 5 years ago, you might have thought, you know, this is kind of before ransomware, if you really think about it. And the threats were really like, oh, it's probably not going to hit me. And the threats at the time were, if you got hit by it, you just didn't even know.
Rebuild
right?
the machine.
Right, or you got like with a virus or something. But a lot of threats were just there to like snoop. Yeah. And just watch what you're doing. And then ransomware kind of came along and made it big and loud, and people knew they were infected.
I spoke to Joe Panettiere the other day. He was saying that, you know, do you think MSPs, that we've got ransomware under control? And I said, it depends what you mean by under control. I said, it's far more invasive and far more sophisticated and far more targeted.
Yeah.
And it's likely to do a lot more things than just the ransomware these days. I said, people have realized that they've got to have, you know, some sort of strategy. If they get hit, they need to be able to recover quickly.
Absolutely.
And the cases where you really see it hitting badly is the places where people just didn't have anything, didn't build anything in.
Right.
And hey, a lot of that can be government, et cetera, too. But again, you know, machine learning helps there. I mean, we identify ransomware attacks and variants you know, all the time. Very quickly.
It's one of the things that is actually very easy to key in on from a behavior perspective. And again, our ability to take what we learn from one device and instantly protect the rest. Again, leveraging the powers that ML provides in processing that data, you know, again, make our solution for MSPs very, very effective against ransomware.